devices, and I know, with apologies from some members, I know Mr. Dixon has a meeting to chair today in the Long Gallery as well, and other members will be coming in due course. Obviously, members, we agreed at our meeting on the 5th of November, or at the meeting on the 5th, we discussed correspondence from the Minister outlining the current position regarding the Desert Crypt Community Safety College Capital Project, following a review by the steering group and agreed an oral evidence session with the Minister and Programme Board officials should be scheduled as soon as possible. And grateful for the Minister and his team, who very quickly responded to that, and hence we're here today to have this meeting. Relevant papers, which members will be familiar with, are in your meeting folder from previous evidence sessions and documents that the committee had received. So let me formally welcome Minister for Justice David Ford to the meeting, and his team, PSNI Assistant Chief Constable Alistair Finlay, Rosemary Crawford, Deputy Director of the Policing, Policy and Strategy Division within the Department of Justice, and Brendan Smith, who's the Acting Director of Central Procurement Director of the Construction Division within the Health Projects Department of Health, Social Services and Public Safety. And as normal, we'll record this on Hansard, and it'll be published in due course. So, Minister, I'm going to hand over to you at this stage to make some opening remarks, and then I'm sure members will have some questions. Minister.
Okay, thank you, Chair. I'll just take a few minutes to put the record straight as to where we are at this stage. My department and the Department of Health fully support the Programme for Government Commitment. What has changed since the last update to the committee in July is the dramatically worsened financial environment. It's not because of any security reasons, as has been alluded to in certain reports carried in the media. The project has not stopped, but nor is it currently going ahead as originally planned. Whilst recognising the disappointment that stakeholders would feel, the steering group decided that it was necessary in the current financial situation to pause to take stock. That group includes the two departmental accounting officers, the chief executive of SIB, and members of the policing board. The view to pause was shared by the accounting officers of the three services. This is the right thing to do, given both the concern about the current financial environment, affordability and ability to meet future running costs, and the consequent impact on likely usage and changing training needs in each of the three services. Whilst the three services, DOJ and DHSSPS, are committed to providing integrated training facilities to improve public services, we cannot afford to build something which is not affordable and which no longer meets the revised needs of the three services in light of the economic reality. So let me outline the next steps. The steering group has asked the programme board, which represents the three services, Central Procurement Directorate, the Policing Board and the Strategic Investment Board, and involves the two departments, to carry out a two-stage review. First, within 2 weeks, to establish what the present position means for the current procurement process and firm up the scope of the second stage. The second stage will look at training requirements in detail and at the three key pillars of affordability, value for money and procurability. These are fundamental to good governance and building a successful college. The steering group will report back to ministers after meeting due a fortnight today, and we will report to the executive.
Okay, Minister, thank you for that outline. A number of just quick questions to get some clarity. In terms of these three key pillars that you referred to that are now going to take place, in essence, does that mean whatever the outcome of those three key pillars will be and the assessment, the procurement process for the current Desert Crypt facility has been abandoned, and you'll be starting from scratch in terms of a new business case? Whatever the outcome will be, will need to be put together and then approval sought.
As I understand it, there is the potential that a new business case may be required, but that is very much on the basis of the assessments which are to be made as part of this review. It's not saying that there will necessarily be a new business case required.
And in terms of the current procurement process, is that now completely abandoned?
Perhaps. Chair, I could comment on that. No, the current procurement process hasn't been abandoned. It's still alive, you know, as we speak. We haven't had any significant engagement with bidders in recent months, given the work that we've been doing on value engineering and reducing the sort of overall cost of the scheme. But that procurement has not been abandoned, and it will await a decision subject to the review as to how we go ahead Obviously, if it's significantly different from the basis on which that was predicated, it will have to change, but we can't make that assessment yet.
The letter, Minister, you conveyed to the committee said that the steering group had considered the current procurement proceeding, but the letter did highlight that there was a view that there were, I think it was, significant risks, but overall there was still a feeling that the procurement could proceed, but it was the financial environment that had changed that led to this current scenario that we're facing. What are the significant risks that was referred to in proceeding with the current procurement process?
Chair, I think those risks, but one of the current risks, the issue of construction inflation and the approval sum that we have. In very broad terms, construction inflation is impacting on this at a rate of approximately £500,000 per month. So if this is delayed for a significant amount of time, we will be out with the approval envelope that we have currently. The estimated cost of the scheme is in the region of £168 million. We have an approval figure for £157 million, and with a 10% tolerance in that, we're just within that. Were that to be delayed for any significant amount of time, it's likely that it could fall outside those limits, and that would require the resubmission of a business case or an addendum to get additional funding for that. The other issue is one of confidence in the construction industry and their willingness to participate in another competition for this. And I think our concern at the minute is that that confidence would be very low, that confidence would have to be built in order to make this an attractive proposition for firms to compete again.
In terms of, Minister, your own comments on, in respect of this, what I'm hearing is this is a pause, there hasn't been a decision taken, but when this was announced you made public commentary and referred to the likes of Mullaghlin and indicated that other sites were now viable options that would need to be considered as part of this pause, which would seem to indicate that you as Minister were moving ahead of the current position of this is a pause on Desert Crete, no decision has yet been taken. You'd already put into the public domain other options that now needed to be considered. So do you want to reflect on that?
I don't think I said that in terms of the current position, but in answer to questions which had arisen about the potential, I do believe that there is the potential that a new business case might be required, which would be of sufficiently much change that we would need to look at the appropriate location for the integrated facilities. But that's not certainly the position we're in at the present time.
And currently then, I think this must be now we're into that second week of this 2 week.
We're actually in the first week of it.
Okay. So we'll anticipate this first phase decision being taken
Yes, 2 weeks from today the steering group is due to meet and we'll receive that report.
Okay. I don't want to rehearse all of the history in this because it's well documented and obviously there's been a lot of criticism about how we got to this point. From my view, it's important that we find out what's going on now. But in light of how this process has been handled from its very conception to issues around procurement, to issues around how the site was even procured, and there are questions that I'm now hearing where there's confidence issues being raised with me about how that came about in and of itself. Is this something, Minister, that you believe should now be referred to the Northern Ireland Audit Office for them to carry out a forensic review as to how this entire process has been managed so that we can get to the real nub of this issue? Because there are very real concerns out there that this has been a botched process which has now cost the people of Northern Ireland a world-class training facility?
Well, I think to say it has cost us a world-class training facility is a long way from where we currently are. I have no evidence to suggest that this matter should be referred to the audit office at this stage. I know there are a number of allegations floating around from different people around various aspects, most of which predates my time in this post. Yes, there are people who have specific concerns, and I have no doubt they will go to the audit office and report those concerns. But at this stage, I personally have no evidence which would suggest it should be referred. There are, however, some contractual issues relating to consultancy, where, as I understand it, there may be the prospect for legal action, and therefore I need to be extremely careful about saying anything on those areas.
Okay, well, I certainly am of a very clear view that this needs to be forensically examined to establish what has went wrong in this process. I don't think it's defensible, having spent over £12 million, to be where we're at. And, you know, this project's on life support, and it's just a matter of time before the switch is turned, in my view. And I don't think anyone can get away with what has happened without being held to account, and we need a forensic examination of it. We need a PAC inquiry into this, and then obviously committees like this can get involved at that point. But I do think, as Minister, you should consider inviting this to take place rather than this committee writing to the auditor requesting that he would carry out that type of work. I think that would be important for you to do that.
Well, I think you need to be careful when you use terms like this, you know, this project being on life support, waiting for the switch to turn off. It may well be that there will be significant changes from what was originally planned. There are differences emerging in the 10 years, for example, in the training needs, never mind the issues of the numbers in the three services who might be requiring those training needs. Alistair can certainly talk about the technicalities of that if you wish, but to suggest that that means that the project is about to be turned off as opposed to revised is, I think, a dangerous suggestion to make at this point.
Revised to the point where I think people in Cookstown, and I'll bring in Mr. McGlone now, certainly feel that the game is an extra time, and you know, your view of what a revision may be could be the upgrading of three standalone facilities and working better together as opposed to fulfilling a programme for government priority commitment.
Well, given that the commitment is to integrated training, I don't see how in any way that programme for government commitment could be met by revamping existing facilities, some of which are frankly well past their, you know, their use by date.
Or indeed, talk about
the facilities that are needed.
Or indeed, we don't have the facilities. The Fire and Rescue Service, in particular, it needs facilities. We need practical training facilities. We can't build the practical training facilities that we need on our existing estate. So there is no sense of us rowing back from the need. There is a, I think, a responsibility of the Programme Board to report this to the steering group in terms of the risks as they understood it, in terms of the public sector funding situation, in terms of the variability of that as to whether we were still building the right thing at quite a large expense to the public purse, and whether it should be considered we need a revision. But there's no sense of any change of practical training need in terms of the services, although there is a sense in terms of a potential change in the educational need, certainly from the police service, and what that looks like because of developments in education and academia.
Mr. McGlone.
Yeah, thanks very much, Chair. And I heard your comment, what's going on now? That has been the constant refrain with this project as it worked its way through the machinations of what were just a mess. And I would have to reflect deep disappointment that here we are again. It's Groundhog Day. People are deeply disappointed within the constituency. And you talk about credibility with the people in the constituency and the construction industry. It really, if there's a way of doing a thing which is the right way and the wrong way, you've certainly picked the wrong one. It is incredible. And people are bitterly dejected, disappointed, at one level about the construction and the investment, but certainly as well as this was a project, wherever it was going to be located at that time, to drive on. It was an integral part of the Patna Port. And people want to see that change. You want to see good, well-educated officers coming out in the proper facilities for them. So I would have to reflect that. Then, as we work our way through this, there's a number of questions that I have for you, Minister, with your forbearance, Chair. The composition of the steering group, who instructs the steering group to meet?
I presume, as I'm not a member of it, that the steering group sets its own arrangements for what it
is. So they just go off and do their own thing without any ministerial direction, involvement. They just do their own thing. No accountability.
No, there is accountability, but the steering group is responsible for the ongoing work, reporting back to two ministers.
Right.
But it's not something that the ministers are chairing.
No, I wouldn't anticipate the sharing it, but presumably they are instructed to do business.
Well, they were instructed to do business a very long period of time ago. It predates my appointment as minister.
So you weren't aware of the meeting, this last meeting, where they came up with these recommendations?
No, I'm well aware of their meetings.
Oh, sorry, right. We can just establish that. I don't want to get the impression that you've been evasive, Minister. You know, can I just ask then, are you committed personally, Minister, to a project going ahead at the Desert Crate site?
I'm committed to the Programme for Government Commitment to provide quality integrated training facilities for the three services.
Desert Crate site?
Well, that is not technically the wording of the Programme for Government.
No, sorry, I'm asking you specifically just about Desert Crate site. Again, if you don't want to answer the question, that answers it all for me. But are you committed to...
No, I answered it in terms of my commitment as a minister to the Executive's Programme for Government. And that is my commitment.
And are you committed to the project going ahead at the Desert Crate site?
Well, in the face of the significant capital costs which have been outlined, in the face of potential reductions in the training requirements of the three services, including, as Alistair has just spelled out, the difference between the academic classroom-type training and the practical training, then I cannot say that I am committed to the current, what I have described as Desert Crate Mark I proposals.
Right.
Because that may not be what is an appropriate use of public funding
right.
in the future.
Are you committed to a project of this ilk at the Desert Crate site then?
I'm committed to the integrated training which is required using the sort of training areas aspects which are in the current plan. But as I have already said, it may be that a revised business case might require to look at the best location for that. That it would be dishonest to suggest that if there is a significant reduction in the needs for the three services, that it automatically, and I use the word automatically, continues at Desert Crate. But on the other hand, Desert Crate is a site which is in existence, for which there are plans covering the training areas, and therefore it is clearly the current number one option.
Right. I'm glad we got there. For the meantime, anyway. Now, then, to explore the other issue around procurement, and I heard what you were saying there, you have a part, well, at this stage, it's a unilateral procurement process which is continuing with the existing project. But surely, in light of this, your procurement process, which is ongoing for your currently revised project,
yes.
subject to whatever this steering group that really doesn't report back to the minister occasionally, but that there is continuing with contractors out there who will see the writing on the wall. So they aren't going to be biting into a procurement process which isn't going to deliver on the same project that they have been advised to deliver on.
I think, yes, Mr. Middle, we understand the importance of building confidence in the construction industry, and we've had many discussions about this, given the sort of the
yes.
difficulties and what steps we need to take to build that confidence. We also have spoken to the five bidders that were shortlisted some months ago to ascertain their level of interest in continuing with the programme, and that was variable. Some are definitely interested, others perhaps want to think about it. So we absolutely appreciate the importance of that confidence, not only for those bidders but also for the whole supply side in terms of their willingness to be involved in this project. So I think however we move ahead with this, we have to engage very closely with them to make sure that they believe that this is going to happen
okay.
and they understand the scope of it. And in terms of the current procurement,
yes.
it's still viable given the broad scope of what we advertised it at remains the same. If that changes significantly,
yes.
we will be bound to enter into a new procurement
yes,
competition.
You've partially answered my question. That's what it's going to come to. If another project is reduced of reduced size or whatever, it might even be significantly reduced design-wise,
yes.
You're back into a tender process, the business case, really back. And just refresh me, how long did it take for the previous one? We'll not talk about the glitches in the middle. How long does that normally take from the establishment of, inevitably there will be another planning application have to go with it to get design issues sorted, all that sort of stuff. right through to your tendering, your advertising, your procurement, your bidders, all that. Just refresh me how long that should, and with the best will in the world, take.
A lot of variables in that, in terms of, you know, there's learning gained from, you know, what we've done already. That should help accelerate it. But I'd be dishonest if I told you that wasn't going to take a considerable amount of time. And if you really put me on the spot, I think I'd be talking about a period of perhaps 2 years or something like that from you would start, you know, an OGU competition to you would actually get someone on site.
Okay,
lots of variables in that, depending on the scope of change and and the people involved.
And then, if I could, to yourself, Mr. Finlay, ask you, is your project management, indeed the policing board, likewise committed to Desert Create as the location for this this college?
Are the police service committed to it?
And policing board, I just don't know what the situation is with the policing board.
I don't know if I want to speak for the policing board, but but my understanding is they were the policing board have been supported of the programme and the project to date.
Yes.
The police service position right about that this is the if we amend the scope of or looking at what the training needs are, we need to establish what the right site is to do that. And the police, I don't think the police service are going to say Desert Creek is necessarily the right or wrong site. But in terms of where we currently are, and I spoke about the differentiation between the academic and the practical, increasingly the training supplied just both by ourselves and the other services is practical training. Practical training makes up a significant chunk of the current plan for the existing site. And that is probably the biggest gap that we are wanting to fill is in terms of...
Can you explain to me what that is, Jess?
Well, that's things like... Well, and on the Desert Creek site, it's multiple firing ranges for firearms training. It is a public order village in terms of public order training. It is a piece of mock motorway for driver and engagement training and for crash training with the fire and rescue service and such like that. So that there... When the actual site of Desert Creek, as currently designed, has about 120 different buildings on it. And the vast bulk of those are really in the practical training area. The area that we have some difference in our reflection over a period of time is more what we would call academic training. Do we use classrooms as many? We are seeing a movement in policing. This is not just policing here, this is moving worldwide, in actual fact, that there is a move towards more pre-employment training. So instead of people coming and training with us from the beginning, there are lots of evidence of people now going and doing training in universities, further education colleges, where they will do relatively short courses and then come to an employer, potentially policing, with a number of different qualifications. First aid qualification, a driving licence, a basic law and procedures qualification. That can be delivered by somebody else.
But with the greatest respect, that's not unusual in any walk of life or any place of employment.
It isn't. No, it's not unusual. And what we're saying is that those changes, as they seep through into policing, potentially affect the numbers of people we potentially train, and the numbers we train will depend on what size our budget is and how we can what we can afford going forward, which was a key factor of the uncertainty that the Chief Constable took when coming to the decisions or making his position in the steering group is the variability of that. But also in this change of training, and some of this we've changed relatively recently, we've changed from probationers, people, trainees coming in to train. Until this current intake, we were training at 33 weeks. We're now training at 22 weeks. That's a different. They get different practical training, but also they do a lot of pre-arrival work online, and they do a lot of online work in the college. So that digitisation, that ability to do things through internet, that has changed how we do things over a period of time. We are also sending our trainers now out to district and department rather than bringing people into the college. That's another change in training, where instead of actually needing a classroom in a block of classrooms, actually we gather people together in a room at a particular place in the district, and we do the training there. That doesn't abstract them from the district. It means we get higher attendance rates. It also means we cut down on the allowances and expenses that people get for coming to training when we're only actually paying the trainers to go there. So there's a number of significant changes that we've put in place. And as the public sector finance piece gets firmer, that's increasingly, we're drilling down in costs and looking for all sorts of ways to make that cheaper. That impacts on the scope of what we need a police training establishment to actually look like.
Okay, I find it hard to establish just why this is a new thing. I just don't understand that, because it's not new to any of the rest of us that have seen this type of thing happening. You're not telling me that the police are in the dark ages in terms of training, are you? No,
no, I'm not. But we have moved over recent times, and police training has moved over different times as to how police training is done, and that would be different in different areas. You know, if you're in public sector, if you're in private sector, for example, Ryanair or such like, they require that you pay for your training. And if you don't meet their standard, you don't get your money back over that period of time. There are a number of different models. Some of those models have crept into public sector areas. They haven't crept. We haven't got all that yet, but we're seeing some variability in all of that. We need to take that into account. We moved, for example, in relation to this tranche of people that we've brought in as trainees, people who want to join the police service, from having no qualifications to actually requiring 5 GCSEs.
Right.
There is movement in how we're going about our business. It's not about in the dark ages. It's about actually setting our sights on how are we doing this, and there's some fundamental changes in how we deliver that training.
Chair, with your forbearance, just one final question to yourself, Mr. Findlay, then. What does that mean for the new project, for a revised project, I should say?
It means us looking at the scope of, first of all, what size do we anticipate our organisation is going to be? Because we've already reduced the number of training days that were required out of that. Some of those training days, a lot of those training days, are driven by national policy. College of Policing minimum standard policy. We are looking to the College of Policing because across the UK that cost is a matter of concern. So the College of Policing, if they are going to change some of that, that will change some of the variability and number of training days that we require. So it's the size of the organisation, policy that's required, and the type of training. The one thing throughout this that I would emphasise that we don't have is the practical training areas. Practical training areas are we need more of that. We need them fit for purpose, and that was certainly the great advantage that was coming in with the current configuration of the project at Desert Creek.
Thank you. Mr. Smith, just one brief question. Is your department committed to a project being on Desert Creek?
I just need to be careful, and maybe a point for the record in terms of the introduction. I think I was introduced as being part of the Department of Health. And
you're moved?
And I've moved. I am Department of Finance and Personnel as part of the Centre Procurement Directorate.
Oh, I see. Right.
So
right.
I'm not really in a position to speak on behalf. I'm only here as the COPE advisor.
Right. We don't have anybody here from Health, no?
No.
No. All right, that's grand. Okay, thanks for that.
Okay.
Thank you, Chair.
I'm going to bring in other members and obviously give Mr. McGoon a lot of latitude.
Well, thank you very much for that.
The constituency interest. But if you can continue with his line of questioning and try and ask questions, we don't have time for statements to be made around this particular project. So if we can keep it to questioning as far as possible, that would be helpful. Mr. Frew.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, straight any questions. You talk about trying to provide or instill confidence in the construction industry. You've said that numerous times here today, but you haven't told us a method of how you would actually do that. You tell us that some of the historical bidders would be interested again. Given the fact that these all had to be consorted because of the scale of the project, how are you going to actually instill confidence that this would be something worth bidding for, and that at the end of it, mm-hmm. it'd be a worthwhile project?
I can answer some elements of this. Others are of more political nature that I'm not qualified to answer at all. But in terms of the technical aspects, we can consider breaking the project down into smaller elements. You know, we've had significant discussions about enabling works, what you might do about building a perimeter or some of the access roads onto the site, those sorts of elements that will give contracting entities the confidence that this scheme is really going to happen. There are other aspects about where the risk lies with contractors and where the risk on issues such as quantities and that, and is it better for the authority to carry those risks or is it appropriate for the contractor to carry those risks? So those are the types of elements that we believe can build confidence with the contracting industry, and we've had sort of quite significant discussions with the five shortlisted bidders in a generalised way about these, and sort of have taken on board their comments back to us in terms of what they feel we would need to do to give them the confidence, you know, to continue in the process.
If I could add, maybe just in informal discussions and contacts I've had with the construction industry, this lack of confidence isn't about Desert Crete project per se. It's actually about large-scale public sector projects, and it's a broader than piece than this. This is just one example that they would reflect to me of the amount of effort that a contractor has to go into to get themselves in a position to bid and such like, and then find a number of projects in Northern Ireland which haven't proceeded. It gives them a lack of confidence of sort of investing in that front end piece.
Minister, have you any comment? Obviously, this business and construction industry has looked to government to try and help them out here with regards to the downturn. But yet, here we are, and whilst this isn't the only project, but this is the project that typifies and illustrates the problem whereby government has been found wanting when it came to assisting the private sector. This was a great project that was heralded as that, and now, with everything that's happened, I wouldn't be surprised if construction companies run away from this.
Well, Brendan and Alistair have given the technical ways in which we might enhance confidence. You know, particularly, I think if it was possible to break the project into smaller individual contracts, it would apart from this, it would make it easier for some of our local businesses to look to without having to form those consortia. I think the political confidence will come if there is a proper review at this stage as to what the needs are. You're informed by that decision from the steering group or by the recommendation from the steering group based on sound financial arguments. The executive will then take a decision as to how to proceed, and I think that then gives a degree of political confidence, especially if some of the practical issues which Brendan and Alistair have talked about have been addressed. It gives a degree of confidence that perhaps this isn't, you know, as has been seen, a project which was too big and which created difficulties, but one which is a series of smaller contracts which are viable for local businesses.
You talk about a review, and there's a 2-week review, and then there may well be a further review after that, but you already had an 8-week review between March and July of this year, I think. What was that review doing?
But that review was looking at the capital costs of what I've called Desert Crete Mark 1. You know, this review is both looking at the procurement position arising from that and scoping out, in the second phase of it, what I talked about, the review of training needs, which Alistair has talked about, the detail as to how those are changing.
But if you were to divide this project into smaller chunks, which then means that more of our industry could bid for it and afford to bid for it, I suppose the way to put it, because there's been thousands of pounds spent on this, thousands, which could well... if this doesn't go the right way, could have and would have wiped out some of our companies. If you break that down into smaller bits and pieces, who's to say that it won't be done in a staggered process over many, many, many years? And also, why then, what's the logic of having it all on the one site?
Well, the logic of having it on the one site is the integrated training opportunities that arise from having it on the one site. I mean, that's always been the key point of this project. The breaking a contract down into different sections of it doesn't seem to me to necessarily tie into the question of lengthy phasing at all. It's a matter of getting one body to, you know, to carry out something within its area of expertise, whilst another company or consortium, you know, deals with other aspects which are within its area of expertise. I think that, you know, that's different from suggesting that automatically means you're going to phase it out over a long period. The reality is all three services need quality training facilities at this time.
Yeah, but no matter what we do now in the future, and this is the last question, Chair, We will review this and we will assess it and we'll redesign it and we'll come up with a price and it will go into the system and it will stay in the system and it will be bogged down in the system and it will not come out the other end and all of those people will have bid again and maybe even been awarded contracts and then the thing will still be stuck and at the end of that the PSNI training regime will move on. The way that people are trained in the health sector will move on and will be in the same position, albeit 5 years or 7 years down the line. How can you give us confidence that things have changed or the environment has changed or decision-making processes has speeded up?
Well, the arcane nature of some of our decision-making processes in and around this building we need to be careful of. I can't give you complete confidence today, but nor should you sit here, you know, with a series of statements as if they were statements of facts, all of which are entirely negative. I think we have, you know, a degree of process which is likely to be of benefit, whatever we proceed from work which has already been done. That's the kind of issue which enables decisions to be taken better and more speedily, accepting Brendan's point that if we need to do significant revision, it will be a lengthy process. But the work which has been done is not all lost. It is work which will inform what goes ahead, you know, depending exactly, you know, how many changes there might or might not be.
But then why can you not just cut off buildings?
Single transferable.
And have the design. If that's all been itemised and tendered for, why can you not just cut off the bits that you do not require?
Well, the reality is you might be in that position, but that's what we need the training needs assessment over the next 2 to 3 months for.
And if I may, Minister, just on that, I mean, we've completed the value engineering term. That was that in 8 to 10 weeks or thereby, where we sought to take further costs out of the bill to try and get it within the cost envelope of the capital consents we had. We didn't manage to do that, but we've taken as much out of that. If we take any more out of that, it was going to change the overall functionality. I think that changing the overall functionality becomes key because actually we can't afford to build what we're wanting to build. But actually, by taking stock and looking at the functionality, we have to decide what functionality we actually need. And it may be that we separate off the academic piece from the practical piece. The practical piece is a bit that certainly on the police service and speaking, if I may, on the fire and rescue service, that's the bits that we actually need more. That is the bigger part of this project. If we decide to do the academic piece in a different way or in smaller scale, then we may well be able to move round about that. But that is the purpose of this review, is actually looking at that. And it's not giving up what we've invested already in the design and then what we've discovered through the design and where we've got to in terms of the value engineering that's taken us to the cost price of where we are. If the preferred bidder had been able to hold on to their price, we wouldn't be having this discussion. We would be building.
That's something I'm keen, because you did state, Mr. Finlay, that construction inflation has been the enemy defeating us all so far the last time you were here. Mm-hmm. But that's not the enemy. The enemy is the time and the length of process that this tendering process has taken.
But the processes have to take a certain amount of time in terms of procurement and the processes and governance round about that. And construction inflation does run at a certain rate. It depends on the overall envelope. We are up at the upper margins of the consent envelope.
Okay, Chair, thank you.
Happy to bring other members in at the end if things are left out as well, but I'm keen to bring, I know some members have an agriculture committee and the minister's under time pressure as well, so if I can get round as many members as quickly as possible. Mr. Elliott.
Chair, thank you, and I'll be as brief as possible. Thank you very much for the presentation. Just wondering, how much has been spent on the project so far?
Rosemary will give us the figures quick. And
yeah, the amount that has been spent so far is 9.7 million.
If you include the cost of the procurement of the site, what does that bring it to?
The cost of the site was 2.85 million, which brings the total to 12.5. So the reason I kept those separate is because the cost of the site isn't included in the overall capital cost of the project.
No, I appreciate that, but it's still the cost of the overall.
Okay. I know in an earlier presentation on the 14th of November 2013, there was an indication at that stage that there may be redress sought against the design team. Has that happened?
It hasn't happened as yet. As we've discussed previously at the committee, the legal advice coming from senior counsel was that that should happen at the end of a process. It's a matter to take back.
Right, at the end of what process? Because we've been through several processes.
Well, that's exactly. I think the question for us now, going back into the programme board, is to get further advice from council as to whether where we are now with this pause is an appropriate time to seek to engage around those particular issues which have gone on for some time. I know have been a matter of concern of members of the committee as to how that continued, and that is a matter that the programme board meets this afternoon, as it happens, and it will be that will be a discussion therein and getting that advice.
Okay. I'm slightly surprised that there was an indication at the start of the presentation that there have been no discussions with the bidders in recent times. I know, Mr. Smith, you said you talked to them some months ago.
Yes.
But why has there not been any recent discussions? Because my recollection, of that 14th of November discussion here was that the bids only held to the end of to December 2013. You know, the bids are a year now out of date or from their holding position. So why has there not been further discussions with the bidders? Can we not be clear that this particular project, is this particular project gone now? Not in the sense of having a training college or safety college, but that this particular project that was bid for and awarded is gone.
I may be commenting. We have never awarded the project. What we did at one stage was appoint a preferred bidder. We went through that process, and it was clear from the discussions we had with the consortia that they were not able to maintain their price. So that collapsed that element of the process. Our contingency position in the event of that happening, and what that was outlined at the very start of the process, was that we would then refer to a straight lowest price competition. And that has been our intention. So the bidders have all been aware of that strategy, of that proposal. I think the value engineering exercise that took place early in the summer to bring the scheme back within the affordability limits has taken place. Now we're faced with these other constraints. We could, at this stage, go out to bidders, clearly given the discussions around the training needs and the need to re-examine it. We don't know whether that is the correct element to purchase any longer. There has to be a review to see, you know, do we need all of the classrooms? Do we need all of the academic training? Is this the right solution? And until we get certainty about that, we can't go back out to the market. But the process is still valid. And I think, as I said, as long as it's generally of the same scale, we take legal advice on this as we're going through. If we believe that it fits within the description of the original sort of advertisement, we can go back out to those five bidders. First of all, we'd have to ascertain, are we going to get competition between three of them? I think we've taken a few ourselves as to how many of those bidders we need to ensure competition in terms of ensuring value for money. But if that's the case, it's still alive. We can go out, and that has been our intention up until very recently.
But it will not be the same project as was originally bid for.
Well, that's to be determined. I think.
I think that's the determination of the review, which will go forward, and it will determine what the scale of that project is. And then we'll have to reflect that back for procurement advice in terms of if the scale of that has changed so materially, then we would have to do something different, that would be my sense.
Yes.
Because I think if not to do that, we would expose ourselves to legal challenge in terms of other economic operators would say, had it been that size at the first time, I would have wanted to pitch for that. We have to do the review work first to see what that looks like, and then consider what are the procurement implications thereafter.
Chair, one final question. We have went through a series of difficulties with this from it started. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the procurement was, I'll use the term poor. They couldn't meet the price that was originally in the budget. The preferred bidder's timescale ran out about a year ago, or almost a year ago. Would you describe this entire process, Minister, as a mess from start to finish?
Well, it wouldn't matter what I chose to describe it as. It's very easy.
I think it is important, Minister. It is important.
Yeah, but would you describe it as a mess? Doesn't actually get us anywhere at the present time.
Absolutely, but would you describe it as a mess from start to finish?
What I'm concerned to do is to ensure that it isn't a mess. That we.
But has it been so far? I think we need it to be clear, Minister, of whether you have confidence in the process so far.
Well, we can all highlight difficulties, and clearly we've already referred to the potential legal issues related to consultants and pricing. So, as I said then, I need to be very careful that I don't stray into that area. But the reality is we've had those problems. It doesn't achieve anything at this stage. What adjectives
I'm... You want to sweep all that under the carpet, what has happened, the difficulties that there has been?
Well, I'm not quite sure how you describe it as sweeping under the carpet when it's been made clear that there are potential legal issues to be followed up. That's not sweeping it under the carpet. That's taking it very seriously. But
have you at least confidence in the current process?
I have confidence in the process which is carrying forward at the present time to ensure that in the light of the very different financial circumstances, we get the best possible community safety college arrangements for the people of Northern Ireland. That's a lot more sensible thing to ask me than to ask me what particular adjectives I might apply to the processes which started before I became minister.
Well, sorry, but you're in position as minister since 2009, from recollection. And quite a lot of this has went on. All the discussions that I've been referring to has been in the last 2 years. Chair, now, I do think we're entitled to an answer. This committee is entitled to know if the Minister has confidence in the process that went before, and you even suggested the reference to the audit committee, and I would support that. But we need to know from the Minister if there is confidence in the process that has went on before, as well as the process that is now underway.
And as I've said, the process started before I became minister. I don't have access to the information of what went on previously. I'm not particularly interested in applying adjectives to that prior process. What I am concerned about is to ensure that we now make the best possible arrangements to get the community safety college that we wish to see.
Dear Chair, I'll leave it.
It is at least embarrassing for you as minister, because you did assert in the Assembly, I can recall, that you would be putting the first spade work into this site some time ago, and you can maybe outline the fact that you went to the executive on this before and had to get some kind of urgent procedure in order to allow things to keep advancing. So you were party to this process while you have been minister. I don't think it's fair to say all of this happened under a different watch, because you
didn't take actions as minister
to advance this current process.
I didn't say all of it happened. I said the process started under a different watch. And it is certainly the case that I and a previous Minister of Health, Social Services and Public Safety gave commitments to advance the process. But we can only do that on the basis of the proper procedures being followed through the proper structures, which is the programme board and the steering committee reporting to us, not ministers taking unilateral action.
Okay. Evan Pitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. What will the Builders College, how much is it going to cost a year to run it?
Well, that is entirely a function of what we now decide is appropriate.
Well, what was on the table, how much is it going to cost to run?
Well, the reality is that we are taking stock at the moment as to what the appropriate training needs of the three services are. And until we know what that is, it's impossible to state what the running cost would be.
But what you were looking at, how much was the running cost going to be?
Do we have the figure for that at this stage?
Sorry? We know the additionality. And this is a bit of a...
Do you want to tell us?
Yes. This is a bit of a technical calculation working from plans. Mm-hmm. But in certain for the police service, it looked as though it would cost us an additional £2.8 million a year to run.
And the fire service and the prison service?
Well, they had much smaller proportions round about that. I'm not sure of their figures, but you know, my focus, I think, understandably, is on the cost of the police service. No, we are the bulk of the the use on the site, and so the bulk of that falls to us.
No, I know that certainly was and is a significant issue for the fire service that they'll be closing stations and proceed with the site, and just trying to elicit from yourselves, indeed, on behalf of the prison service. We don't know as yet because no one gave us the answer as to what the consequences would be for the prison service. In terms of, obviously, there's £12.5 million would be lost if we didn't proceed with this particular site and location, indeed a considerable amount of that would be lost in any event. And the bite-sized chunks, how can we actually achieve that? I'm not saying you can't, but I'm asking the question, how do you achieve it? Do you drop, for example, your motorway? Do you not bother diverting the river? I know you're spending around £50 million underneath the ground. You know, is there the ability there to make considerable savings from that particular element of it?
Well, I think we need to be clear. First of all, my understanding is we're talking about something like £29 million for infrastructure costs, including the security fence, including roadways, including serviced docks, including foundations of buildings. That's rather less than £50 million.
That's the more recent one.
And it's not all below the ground either. Mm.
That's the more recent one. That's not the initial proposal.
I'm not aware there was ever at £50 million below the ground. Mm.
Mm. So how do you,
that would be my understanding. Yeah,
the question is, how do you make the savings in the bite-sized chunks?
I think there's sort of two different questions in amongst that. There's how does it, first of all, in the review, we decide what elements of the overall concept can either be downscaled or removed completely. The bite-sized chunks elements that we were talking about would be an alternative procurement route, mm-hmm. where in actual fact, instead of having a single economic operator who builds the whole thing, that we actually we split it into themes, whether that's groundworks or you know, different parts, or we split that into smaller parcels of work. That would be where the bite-sized chunks came from. But stage one is for us to undertake the review and see, in terms of the scope of training facility, what elements do we think either get downscaled or removed from that, and what the consequence of that, and what remains, and what the costing from that. Now, we are in the position where we have all the detailed costing information in terms of what we've got from the new cost consultants that were part of the design consortium. So we've got detailed costs. We will be in a position in a relatively quick time to, after we've analysed what the training needs are, we'll see what's the consequences of that on the capital build. And then from then to discuss with Brendan and colleagues about what would be the procurement route that would give effect to that.
So, getting tourism element of it, is that something that is being part of? And we're looking at what our basic needs are in terms of training?
Yeah, training tourism isn't part of the business case, isn't part of the rationale.
Was it ever?
It's been spoken about, but it's never part of the business case. Actually has to deal with the facts of demands of this is for training of three services and what the training needs are. There was an enhancement value or a notion of this would be a useful thing in terms of, in particular, the amount of work that the police service was doing with other parties, primarily through NICO. Now, our position on that has changed in as much as in the current construct with our current funding. We're not able to afford to send people to other countries, nor are we able to afford the training time and space to bring people in. So we have been working with NICO and managing some disappointment in terms of countries who might want to take advantage of that. But equally, that's not just us. The amount of global law enforcement coming together, if you like, to train or to have conferences has reduced. The amount of spend that's coming out of FBI or the Canadian Service, such like, has reduced. So the amount of that that's going around is much smaller than it might have been 5 or more years ago. So primarily we want to, and this takes us back to the world-class comment, We want to build a fit-for-purpose training facility to deliver world-class training. And I think that's is an important distinction.
More questions, but leave it to them, Mr. Chair, given time.
Mr. McGuinness.
Okay, just one quick question, that is, $53 million has been placed, provided for in the current budget.
Sorry.
What if this project doesn't go ahead, what happens to the $53 million?
The simple answer to that is that it is the responsibility of DfP to discuss that issue with the Treasury. It was specifically allocated for the Community Safety College. And if it was, you know, it is also time limited, and any changes to that would be a matter for DfP to follow up.
Thank you, Chair.
Mr. McCartney.
Thank you very much, Chair, and apologies for being late. So if I asked a question previously answered, apologise in advance. I don't want to repeat some of the questions which have been there, but I think we all share the general concern. But one of my concerns would be that at the last briefing we talked about recouping some of the costs from the professional fees, mm-hmm. yet there's nothing in place to do that at present, some 4 or 5 months on.
No, as you maybe recall from the last couple of sessions, we were working against the very firm legal advice that we did that at what was described as at the end of the process. And Mr. Elliott asked earlier just about, well, when was the end of that process? And the programme board meets this afternoon, which will be the first time the programme board has met since the steering group met. So we're working on the commissioning of the and delivery of the work to the steering group. But that is also a question now that will go back to senior counsel in terms of where we are now. If we pause this in this particular place, is this the right time to seek to resolve that issue? And we will take that advice. I know, because I've been speaking on other issues, senior counsel has only just returned back into Northern Ireland, hasn't been available, been out of the country for a period of time. So that will happen, commissioning of that will happen this afternoon.
Okay, thank you. And just in terms of public perception of this, I mean, obviously it's a programme for government commitment, mm-hmm. and that's been sort of stated, but how much money is in place for this project to be taken forward?
We had a capital consent of $157 million. That would be phased over the years in terms of delivery and such like, and we'll be working through colleagues in DOG with DfP to get the phasing of that appropriate. But that was our current capital consent envelope was $157 million.
So would you understand why there would be a degree of public concern that there's £157 million in place to build a training college for 3 services for a population of 1.5 million, and yet we can't seem to deliver it?
I think we would understand the concern that the delays in the project. I mean, I think from the services perspective, our training facilities have been ageing and have been anticipating the delivery of new training facilities for some number of years. So there's no dragging of feet or from the services perspective, and there is a frustration amongst the services about the inability that we ourselves have to deliver this. But those frustrations have arisen, as we've discussed at the committee, on a number of different issues in terms of cost envelope, the design, the changes to around about that, the procurement issues, and now in terms of the public sector finance changes that have led us to the conclusion that we need to take another review rather than seeking to press ahead and necessarily build the wrong thing for the wrong time.
No, but I accept the latter part of your point, but I mean, looking at this from the beginning, you know, practically £160 million set aside. You know, it's hard to imagine how anyone can come up with a college to fit the needs. It's mind-blowing, nearly.
Well, there's two aspects of that, if I may. One, if this was a conventional college, you could build it very quickly. because it would be a box relatively with relatively square rooms and flexible space. The vast bulk of this isn't. The vast bulk of this is quite complicated design, which is in the practical training areas, taking into account all the necessary health, safety and risk assessments that have to go with that. So they're actually, for example, in terms of the firing ranges, all the design features that have to go into that to keep it at the best fit for purpose, most appropriate facilities. That's design that takes a longer period of time than just a conventional college. The conventional college bit is relatively straightforward. The fitting the rest of that onto the land, but that design's now done. The question is, how best do we use that design as we move forward?
Yeah, is there a comparable college somewhere else that you could look at and say, that's what they got for £160 million, why couldn't we do it?
There are other facilities in the United States and Canada. And if you go back, I mean, one of the issues that's been in the committee has been the design. And the Perkins and Will, who are the contractors, they won the procurement competition to be the designers on the basis of their involvement in those type of works in other parts of the world.
But is a part of this, and this is my final question, is a part of this is that people hear that there's £160 million available, but let's see if we can stretch it out, and the stretching out has put us in the position that we're in today?
I'm not sure anyone's stretching it out.
If you're told, and I think I made this point in the last meeting, if someone comes along and says, do you have £157 million to do something, then I find it difficult how, with all the professionalism that's there, that they can't come up with a budget. But there might be a view that if you feel, well, they say we can build it for 160, but if you ask them for 180 million, they may come up with it. So the temptation is to come up with the £180 million figure.
We have, if you go back to the procurement exercise and where the preferred bidder couldn't hold their price, there has been a detailed costing evaluation done by the cost consultants to put, I think, probably what is it, a more realistic figure on that. So that was the starting point, recosting the project. Then we've done the value engineering, which we've redesigned that in terms of taking cost out of that. Currently, where that leaves us is what we've got on the table can't be built for the capital sum we've got. So what bits come out, and that's where the review comes in.
Well, except that, but in the middle of this process, there wasn't a flagging operation in place to detect that it was going over budget. That's why we're having the discussion of the first question around the professional fees. There wasn't the rigour built into this to detect that people were going over budget. And I might be wrong about this, and I'll say that, but I think the temptation is that people felt that it didn't matter about the budget as on the table. We'd probably stretch this.
I could just address that point, Mr. McCartney. Throughout the process, and I think I mentioned this at one of the earlier meetings, we were getting regular monthly reports from the design team on the projected cost of the college. I can recall for at least a year that varied somewhere between the parameters of 98 million to 104 million as things moved in and out of the design. But there was an absolute consistency about that in terms of the reporting from the design team, and that is the issue that we still have with the design team in terms of the competence of that advice. And that clearly has had a sort of a critical impact on the project at that stage. There have been significant changes to the design team at a very senior level, a complete change of cost consultants within the design consortia. And I'm really only speaking as a COPE, but I've regular contact with the team that are delivering this on a day-to-day basis, and I understand that both myself and the team have a lot more confidence in the cost consultants that are currently engaged in the process than those that were initially appraised. There actually were mechanisms to flag that up, and there was an independent review of elements of that cost. But unfortunately, I think a failure of the design team as a whole led to that not being effective. But there were mechanisms in place to try to address that very concern that you identified.
I think it's fair to say that if the design team had got it right first time, we wouldn't have been having these conversations. We would be. Construction would be virtually finished, if not already finished.
But just this final point, but see, I don't think we've been told why the design team were so wrong.
And I think the challenge around that is where we go with the legal advice about how to get into the detail of that, and in terms of getting redress for that.
And it's fair to say that this current team in front of us isn't the same team that was there before, but to lay it all at the door of the design team, I think is a little bit disingenuous, because, Brendan, at the last meeting you said the project team and the project board have taken steps to ensure that there is much greater scrutiny and much greater involvement with cost consultants in particular. Doesn't say a lot about the people that were responsible for overseeing this, which you replaced Mr. Finlay as the head of.
I think we would say that clearly the result of that experience, lessons were learned.
Yeah, well, it's been a very costly lesson that has been learned in respect of the way in which the project team managed this. I accept the critical failure here was on the part of the design team, Perkins and Will, and there's legal action hopefully being taken. But there was acknowledgement in the last meeting that the levels of scrutiny that was being applied by the project board now is not what was being applied before you came on board. I have a quick point, Alistair, for you. You're obviously in charge of this whilst you've been acting Deputy Chief Constable. Is the intention for you to remain responsible for this?
No, I think Mr. Harris is going to assume responsibility for it in the role of deputy, having got into that post, and he's going to be there for the next 5 years and such thing. Mm-hmm. I will take it forward for the next short term, I think, probably to finish, where this has taken us to, and its next generation will be led by Mr. Harris as chair. I will remain on the programme board, which was the position I was in before Judith retired.
Mr. Harris hasn't sought to delegate you to keep going in this role, no?
In fairness, I did volunteer, but he feels it's the, I think, appropriate thing for the Deputy Chief Constable to lead that.
I've only one more member and then we'll wrap it up. Mr. Douglas.
I thank you, Chair. I'll be very quick, just a couple of quick questions. I suppose my question is to Rosemary. You mentioned about the figure, plus the combined figure of about £12 million. But obviously there's an ongoing cost on a daily basis, I'm sure, in terms of security, insurance and all that. Would you have a rough idea how much it's still costing on a monthly or an annual basis?
Or do you mean in terms of the site?
The site itself, yeah.
I don't have that information at my fingertips, Alistair, do you?
I don't have it. Two things. One of that, there is some income that we get because we have previously let the land out to a farmer. We've done another short-term let round about that to maintain use of the land. And there has been, and we have allowed use of land for certain purposes. There is some work that goes on to maintain things like hedgerows and ground maintenance. It's limited, but we do check the site on a regular basis. But the costs, I don't have an exact figure. I can write to you if you would like them, and I can get you that.
Yeah. Maybe a question to Brendan. The Minister talked about the business case, and I assume that there was an economic appraisal that was carried out and signed off by somebody somewhere along the line.
Yes, I think both departments, at that stage I was in the Department of Health, and both departments signed off that business case, and the option that was chosen did demonstrate considerable benefit over the other options, over the sort of three sites alone, significant benefit, and my understanding is with the addendum that's still the case.
Yeah.
And will there have to be a new economic appraisal, or will it be an updated economic appraisal?
That's probably subject of discussion with the DFP in terms of it probably will depend on the scope of the change and whether that can be accommodated by means of an addendum or whether that requires a new case.
Yeah.
Just I've been involved in the economic appraisal over the years, and like one particular it took 2 years to get from starting to completion.
It can be.
And my final question is that obviously one of the options in the economic appraisal is to do nothing. What is the cost of us doing nothing?
I think it's fair to say that there wasn't actually a do-nothing option, because the do-nothing option wasn't a viable option. So there's a base option that brings things up to basic health and safety standards. Mm-hmm. That was a significant expenditure. I can't recall exactly, but I think for Garnival it might have been something of the order of 45 million.
46 million is the figure that's in my mind. It wasn't quite do-nothing. It was in order to provide the existing facilities with in a proper function, it would take that to upgrade it. But that didn't give us any of the tactical training facilities and benefits.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Chair. A couple of just residual, Mr. McGlone, and then Mr. Poot, and that's it.
Yeah, thanks very much, Chair. Just very briefly, in the commitment alleged that for the 53 million that has been given to you, Minister, was there anything else with that which said this is 53 and there will be additional to follow? In other words, was there actually a financial longer term commitment to this project or to a project?
My understanding is that 53 million pounds is the commitment from the Treasury,
right,
towards the towards the Community Safety College project. Now it was time limited, so any issues about rollover or diversion would have to be discussed between DFP and Treasury.
And are you aware, but I'm listening to Mr. Smith is here, this could be 2 years, even with the best will in the world. And for those of us who have sat through council meetings where council officials brought this project to fruition, put in the application 10 years ago, and if it's 2 years in the making, well then clearly you're going to have a bit of an overlap here of a year at least. So are you aware of Department of Finance and Personnel, or maybe I should address that to you, Mr. Smith, making a robust case to the Treasury to secure that 53 million for a project which may well be a year beyond that before it even comes to the point of laying a brick, or potentially laying a brick?
I think that probably falls outside my remit, Mr. McGlone, but I am aware of ongoing conversations between DFP and Treasury regarding the project and regarding that end-year flexibility and carryover of monies.
Yeah. If I may add, just DOJ officials work very closely with colleagues in DFP on this. At the minute, the end-year flexibility pot currently sits at 78 million. We continually update colleagues in DFP in terms of the progress that the project is making, so that they're aware of what the requirement might be. But in terms of the baseline amount that DOJ has for this year, that was originally just under 16 million, 15.7. Because we know that we won't spend quite as much this year as had been envisaged, we've already made an easement of that back to the executive under the October monitoring round, and that amount of 7.2 million has already been reallocated. We'll continue to look at the in-year position. We will look at it again come the January monitoring, and we will continue to work closely with colleagues in DFP so that they know what the position is, what the profile of spend is likely to be over future years, and what therefore the requirement would be in future spending reviews.
Is there a possibility that this 53 million could be lost?
That will be entirely a matter for the Department of Finance and Personnel working with Treasury.
Okay, thanks very much, Chair.
Thanks, Chair. In terms of what happened, I assume no one is suggesting that the constructors conspired to hype the price up and therefore it is inflated. Consequently, the design team got it wholly and completely wrong, to the tune of £30-40 million. You indicated, I think Brenton indicated, that it was independently reviewed. By whom?
By another local consultancy, another local cost consultant, White Young Green.
White Young Green. And is your Cope still using that consultancy?
That consultancy is still being used.
Mm-hmm.
I think the question is probably more around the information that they were given to review, but it's tied up in the whole sort of assessment of the design team performance and where we take that with potential legal action. So okay, probably wrong for me to stray any further into that.
Okay, so wasn't their fault because they didn't get the right information? Why did they not get the right information?
I think that's really part of that exercise.
Question for the design team.
Mm.
Mm.
No. Sure. Thank you.
Okay. Minister and their team, can I thank us very much for coming to the committee. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, members, our next meeting is tomorrow, 2 p.m.
Thank you, Chair.